So I'm extremely pleased to welcome as our first main speaker, Professor Michael Pakaluk, who spent some time in Edinburgh where he got to know the Dominicans of this province. He was for a time in the Institute for Psychological Sciences and at Ave Maria University, and he's now Professor of Ethics at the Catholic University of America and a member of the Pontifical Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas. His recent books include Moral Psychology and Human Action, if I got the title right, and can read my abbreviations, in Aristotle, and an introduction to Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics. But I got to know him as an expert in this area by his earlier edition and commentary on the two books on friendship from Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics. So we're extremely pleased to welcome Professor Pakaluk to speak on friendship's contribution to psychological well-being in Aristotle. More magisterial. Entirely appropriate.
Well, thank you, Richard, for the invitation to be here, and thank you to the Jubilee Center for sponsoring and helping to support this conference, and I'm pleased to be here in Oxford and meet new people. This paper or presentation I'm going to give you has two parts. It's going to begin with a rather, well, somewhat informal introduction. I'll just be speaking from notes. And then a portion where I want to read a paper. And the paper part is going to be on a particular note of friendship, a particular condolence, the possibility of one friend's sorrowing with another, lightening the burden of sorrow of that friend. Aristotle has a treatment of this in Book 9, Chapter 11, the Nicomachean Ethics. So just a few lines, really, but the way it's, the argument there and the way it's taken up by Aquinas is very, very interesting. So it needs to be looked at with a little bit of care, and that's what I'm going to read from a text at that point. I also want to say that responsibility for that is really should be given to air traffic control at JFK. Because my story in getting here is that I was supposed to get here almost more than a day earlier than I got here, but I kept on going to the airport, finding out my flight to JFK was delayed, I'd be missing a connection, went back home, did this three times, and then finally got here. But in all of the movement back and forth, I kept working on the paper and decided that I really should give more attention to condolence among the various aspects. So the fact that there's this kind of red paper that's embedded in my talk today is, again, you can thank air traffic control at JFK Airport. Now, I want to say first something about friendship in Aristotle in a general way, and then something about psychological well-being in Aristotle in a general way. Now, on the handout, I schematize the Nicomachean Ethics, and I keep thinking about the structure of the work and whether it has unity and so on. And I was looking at in what I think is a new way today, and that's represented in this listing at the very beginning of your handout of what the subjects in the Nicomachean Ethics are. Now, it's a proposition of Aristotle in Practical Reason that in Practical Reason you begin with the end and then you work backwards from that through a kind of backward engineering to a starting point that you can actually affect. And it's because he thinks of Practical Reason this way that he begins Book 1 in the Nicomachean Ethics with a discussion of the ultimate end of human life, eudaimonia. And he defines it as famously as activity of the soul or actualization of the soul in accordance with the virtues. And the next step, so to speak, if you're engaged in practical engineering, would be to determine how to acquire the virtues, and then how to actualize them. In the acquisition of virtue is discussed in Book 2 of the Nicomachean Ethics. In the actualization of virtue, in Books 7, 8, and 9 of the Nicomachean Ethics, you kind of look then at the middle parts where the virtues are elaborated and discussed as kind of an appendix. So you might say, take for granted everybody knows what the virtues are. I think Aristotle would actually have thought that. And if you want a little bit more detail about what the virtues are, then here they are. But it's really books 1, 2, 7, 8, 9, and 10, which are the practical argument of the Nicomachean Ethics. And I'm just making this point so that to convey, I don't know, I suspect that there are people with different degrees of understanding the Nicomachean Ethics in this room, but he understands the reason he spends two books in the Nicomachean Ethics on philia, on friendship, is that that is the context in which the virtues are actualized and best actualized for Aristotle. And pleasure is discussed for a similar reason, because it's a, as it were, a prompt or a sign of the actualization of virtue. Now, about philia being translated friendship, I discussed this yesterday at a seminar we had on friendship, and it's commonly said, as Father Richard did, that we neglect friendship today, and Aristotle devoted two full books on it. And I've said that, it's probably in two or three books that I've written as well, but I don't think that it's true. I no longer believe that, and I'll tell you why. I think that what we regard as friendship, which is an intimate bond between companions who have freedom to associate with one another, which is expected to last over a lifetime, etc., etc. Aristotle spends maybe 5 chapters of the 26 chapters on friendship discussing that. And he discusses it mainly as a paradigm, as a clear case. He's mainly interested in what we would call social relations, or bonding, or identification of one person with another in all contexts of human life, within the family and voluntary associations with fellow citizens. And so it's more appropriate to talk about the two books on friendship as books on love. I mean, it sounds kind of, you know, sentimental perhaps, but I really think that that captures better what he's interested in. He's interested in bonding, affection, and identification. And these are all phenomena related to love, and friendship is just one, what we call friendship is just one example of that. So if you do accept that gloss on what's going on in those two books, then you could say that Aristotle regards relationships characterized by love as the best and most suitable context for the actualization of the virtues and necessary for the attainment of happiness. And I think if you put it that way, that gives a much better understanding of what's going on in the ethics. And it's actually kind of striking them that he's devoting two full books to love, which is, I think, one reason why St. Thomas Aquinas regarded him as a bosom buddy, so to speak, somebody who could easily appropriate the thought of Aristotle. Okay, now, as regards friendship, just this one other point. He thinks of friendship as provided by nature. That, of course, we know that he says Aristotle is by nature a social, political, civic animal. And he regards friendships as arising, so to speak, naturally provided for man, and also having a very unusual characteristic of being, so to speak, universally serviceable. He spends a lot of time in various places talking about this. That, here's one example, that in youth, in prime, and in old age, a friend is valuable, very necessary for living well. Among young people, for correcting them, keeping them on the straight and narrow, people in the prime for achieving noble deeds, people in older age for mutual assistance. And this puzzles him and fascinates him, how something provided by nature can be, so to speak, generally necessary for human life. And this is what leads him to develop the idea of friendship in the central case as being complete. It has packed into it all three reasons for which you could want or need another human being: goodness, usefulness, and pleasure. And that's what enables a friendship to be something which across the lifespan can be profitable and good for you, because it has all three implicit. Okay, so that's just in the very briefest way, friendship in Aristotle and the significance for him. Now what we're going to do this morning as a presentation is something I Father Richard said I spent 2 years doing. I was at the Institute for the Psychological Sciences. You take something out of a philosophical context, and now you're applying it to a psychological context, and you try to do that without doing violence to the philosophy, and also doing arriving at something that's practically useful, because if it's merely theoretical, it won't be of interest to psychology. Psychology, at least, you know, we're thinking of clinical psychology here. So, now, here's a problem. The title of the talk is Friendship's Contribution to Psychological Well-being in Aristotle, but Aristotle doesn't have a concept of psychological well-being. But here's an additional puzzle. He should, really. And here's why, because he thinks that the human body, he follows Plato in this, is a kind of picture of the soul. Wittgenstein's famous for saying that, but Aristotle and Plato said it before that. And he thinks that strength of the body is a picture of virtue in the soul. But he also holds, as everybody else did in the classical tradition, that there are at least two goods of the body. One is health and the other is strength. So he does have a place for this good of the body, which is health. And therefore he ought to have a place for this good of the soul, which is not quite virtue, but which is something like health of the soul. But he never develops that. He never talks about health of the soul, even though some Isocrates, you can find in other places, people use that kind of language and they use it in what they understand to be a metaphorical way. Aristotle doesn't, so to speak, leap on that metaphor and develop a picture of psychological health. And to figure out why would be to study the history of psychology, why there isn't mental health in a writer such as Aristotle. I just want to propose three reasons why. I hope it's not too much of a digression. I think that he was probably from a medical family. He was well familiar with the medical tradition. You can see this in the Problemata, which is Aristotelian school. Certainly he regards health as an imbalance of material constituents of the body. Disease, illness is an imbalance in the material constituents of the body. And disease and health are linked together very closely in the classical mind. They're opposites. And they are very close to defining health simply as the absence of disease. So if you can't think of mental disease, because you view it as a disproportionate material constituents, then you can't easily arrive at the notion of mental health. Here's a second reason that I think Aristotle is very sympathetic to the view of Plato in Republic Book 1, that the soul regarded as a soul and in its power is, so to speak, perfect. And he also thinks that activities of the soul or functions of the soul, each of them are mapped onto organs of the body. Organ means instrument. So a function of the soul has an instrument in the body through which to carry out its function. And so he tends to think of infirmities and the function of the soul as infirmities in the instrument, in the organ. So blindness would be a very good example. So we're blind because something happens to the organ, the eye. And the power of seeing may still be there, even though the organ is affected. It's a disputable point in Aristotelian psychology. And then a third point is that there's no subject of psychological well-being for Aristotle, and you'd want there to be a subject. He thinks of health as something that's in a subject. He thinks of this so strongly that in the metaphysics, when he wants to give an example of focal meaning or Prosthen analogy, he uses the health of a subject, of an animal body, as a central case of the notion of healthiness. And he doesn't have a sub. There is no subject for psychological health for Aristotle. There's no separately existing soul, of course. He's not a dualist. And there's also no unity of consciousness. Now, it's very hard to think back to the days before Descartes, when Descartes could say in his second meditation that to think and to sense and to perceive and to feel, they're all the same kind of thing. And so later, for example, in the analytic tradition, we have this idea of a relationship of awareness or consciousness, of a sense datum or something like that. But this is post-Cartesian. Aristotle does not have an idea of a unity of consciousness. And so there's no single background which could be the basis or the receptive subject of psychological health for Aristotle. Nonetheless, I think in an Aristotelian spirit, we could speak of psychological well-being, as I said, he did have a placeholder for it. And to do that, I want to use this, this statement that's attributed to Freud sometimes, that psychological health or well-being is the capacity to work well and to love well, and it turns out that Freud actually never said that. But and he said things that are actually very close to Aristotle, but I won't go into that now. But if I like that definition anyway, and a lot of people do, which is why they associate it with Freud. But if you accept that definition and understand working well as activity or actualization of the soul, then we could take psychological well-being for Aristotle or health not as a condition of individual consciousness, but something like someone's a minimal realization for a person of the network of social relations which he's supposed to have by nature. In other words, I want to say that for Aristotle, psychological well-being is inherently a social condition, if indeed man is a social animal, so to speak. And so if we want to speak then of the contribution of love and friendship to psychological well-being, that's like saying the contribution of health to health. And that's actually not a bad way of speaking, because healing is typically the use of the health of the body to address the absence of health in the body. So we want to speak of healing from a point of view of psychological well-being as a matter of drawing upon the resources of psychological well-being to deal with those areas in which it doesn't exist. And these are all regarded on this Aristotelian view as a kind of embeddedness in social relations characterized by some minimal degree of bonding and identification and love. Okay. Now, in the original version, the pre-JFK traffic control version, I went through various notes of Aristotle's treatment and friendship and talked about how they might have this remediating role. And I'll just mention three of them because I want to go on to condolence and I don't know what the time looks like for this talk. But one is this aspect of the completeness of the friendship. Because Aristotle believes that if the three bases on which you could want someone's company and association at all are included in a relationship, that implies both stability of that relationship and a certain kind of resilience, because you don't have to go outside of the relationship. And he would even encourage the forming of such relationships because of the unity of life they would imply. And also the conversion or change in how you understood pleasantness and usefulness. So if you have one of, and there's so much to be said about this, but I'll just say it very briefly. If you have one of Aristotle's friends for pleasure, Aristotle thinks the kind of pleasure you get from such a friend is a pleasure, let's say, of being entertained. This friend knows how to say things which will, so to speak, tickle your fancy and make you pleased. But a virtuous friend, insofar as you get pleasure from that relationship, is more like your sharing in the pleasure that this person has inherently by acting virtuously. I think of somebody who's cheerful, optimistic, who enjoys working hard, enjoys doing good for others. And if you're in this person's company, if you share in the joy that this person has, that's the way in which you're pleased by a virtuous person. It's very different from, say, listening to funny jokes. So he thinks that a kind of transformation in how you understand being pleased in the company of someone needs to take place. And I think there's interesting psychological implications of this. I just want to mention, that's just one thing, right? So the next thing is, he has a discussion, this is in Book 9, Chapter 7. He raises it in connection with the question of, Who takes the greater interest in the other? Is it the person who does good or the person who receives the good? If you have a benefactor and a beneficiary, who takes the greater interest after the act of benefaction? Is it the benefactor or the beneficiary? And it turns out to be the benefactor. And I would want to draw on that discussion for the, I think, important notion for psychological well-being of living outside of ourselves. of taking our good to be located in persons and projects and things other than, so to speak, conditions of my body and my emotions and my immediate environment. And for Aristotle, this is a consequence. It's something that's achieved. And it can't be achieved, so to speak, by an act of the will or by a change of the attitude. It actually has to be achieved through action, where you effect and do certain things, and then thereby become committed to them and take an interest in them. And I think that has all kinds of interesting implications, too, for clinical psychology. And then the third thing I wanted to discuss, just touching upon as a superficial or general way as a note, would be his notion of a friend as another self. And this is also a very deep and complex subject. But what he means in calling a friend another self is that you establish in your actions and in your habits and affections an analogy, where the friend is typically treated in a way that's analogous to the way in which you treat yourself. So A is to A as A is to B. Now, he thinks that other self is verified in anything that one wants to call a philia, in any sense of the term, no matter how extended, or any person towards whom you want to use the term philos, friend, or beloved. And what I think is of psychological importance in this notion is I want to call the idea of an institution. So I want to describe an institution as a structure in which habits of treating others as other selves are imitated, and they're made, so to speak, a matter of regulation or law. Let's put it in that crude way. And then people who don't have the interior dispositions or habits themselves or affections that correspond to this nonetheless can enter into the institution and over time grow in those habits and affections and attitudes so that they internalize, say, the structure of the institution. And if we admit that this is an institution can be defined in this way or described in this way, and admit, too, that this process of growing into the structure of an institution is possible. And then finally add the idea that when you're related, institution embodies an other self relationship, which implies a relationship of a person to himself. So you can't but be related to another person as another self without, therefore, some implication of it, how you're related to yourself. Following from that, I realize that was not a good English sentence, but Thucydides would understand. he wrote every sentence like that. But if you accept that, then institutions imply the development of a certain concept of oneself. And if it's a good institution, it would be a good concept of oneself. So I think this has an interesting implication for clinical psychology, because I think a lot of people are at sea because of a certain, I'll just put it in this way, very, very crude way, a certain informality of society that has existed since the 1960s, and the absence of objectivity of institutions and good institutions. And so it's much harder to attain a stable concept of self and one which is a beneficial concept of self, which is, so to speak, naturally related to doing good to others through the decline of institutions. And I'll just put it in that way and just leave it. But I think that that's another interesting direction one can go in from Aristotle's account of friendship for psychological purposes. Okay, so the three I mentioned were the completeness of friendship as implying stability and unity, living outside of ourselves as being a consequence of benevolence, active benevolence. And finally, institutions as being ways in which we learn a good concept of self. And my friend Bradford, is that your name? Bradford,
Sam?
Are you a philosophy student, Solon?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is going to strike you as completely strange, right? That I'm taking Aristotle's ethics and applying it to psychology, but it's kind of interesting too, isn't it, at the same time?
No, definitely.
Yeah. Bradford knows this is unlike anything that professional philosophers do with these texts on Aristotle, and yet it's kind of interesting how they can be used in this way, and very fruitful in this way. So, Okay, now I want to turn to condolence in particular, and this is the red part of my paper. Okay. So, Richard, am I finished with my time?
I'm done with it.
Okay. Just let me know how much more time I can have.
Oh, plenty of time.
I'm fine?
Yes.
You just have a kind of blank check here.
Absolutely. 10, 15 minutes.
All right, so the first thing about language. So we have in Greek, sum algeo, sulepeo. We have in Latin, condolere, contristare, compassio. And I want to bring up two important ideas about these words in the classical tradition. One is that they all import some notion of pain versus pleasure. But how pain is understood by classical writers is much broader than our notion of pain. So we think of maybe bodily pain as being, this perhaps Cartesian view as well, the clearest case of pain. And mental pain is metaphorical. It may be significant, but it's metaphorically pain. In the classical world, no such distinction was drawn. And pain encompassed any kind of anguish, sorrow, or distress. And pain was understood more in relation to the frustration of a love than in its correlation, where it was located, or its correlation even with pleasure. So that's the first thing to understand. We think, we use a term like condolence or condolera, we were talking about a very broad range of phenomena, that there are many different ways in which one can sorrow and sorrow along with somebody. That's the first point. The second point I want to make is I want to distinguish between, it's easier to get the point across using pain, being pained at someone's pain and being pained along with someone's pain. So here's the example. I'll read at this point. So Jairus loses his daughter and is greatly downcast. You are Jairus' friend, and you see that he is downcast, but you do not know yet why. In this case, you are downcast at his being downcast. Okay, so the fact that he is suffering causes you suffering, and there is an other-self relationship already verified. But if, as Jairus' friend, you love his daughter too, and think of her as related to him as your daughter is to you, and would have grieved over her death even if Jairus were no longer living, could not grieve himself. And then when you are with Jairus, you grieve over her death, understanding that you take the same relation to her death as Jairus does, because you are with Jairus. Then you are downcast with him. And notice how much more I had to say about this. Because it is really very complex. And to arrive at this view, arrive at this attitude requires, let's say, a little bit of work. Psychological work to see into someone's soul, if you will, in this way. So the first is being pained at somebody, the second is being pained with them, and it's important to kind of see, and the terms in Greek and Latin are used for both. Okay, so I also want to say, in discussing this passage from Aristotle, I do want to bring in St. Thomas, and you'll see why, because this discussion goes beyond Aristotle's and is more interesting in certain ways. Okay, so now I want to turn to the question which Aristotle raises, and he gets there through dialectic, which I don't want to recapitulate here, but let's just ask the question, how it is that the condolence of friends lessens our sorrow? And let's take it for granted, as Aristotle does, that this does happen. All right, so we want to ask the question, well, how does it happen? And it's very paradoxical, but Aristotle doesn't stress the paradox of it. Aquinas does, which is interesting. Because condolence means to feel sorrow with someone's sorrow, so initially you'd think, well, condolence multiplies sorrow. Or you've got one more sorrowing person, right? So how is it that that takes away the pleasure? Sorry, it takes away the sorrow of the first person. Why doesn't it just make him more sorrowful? And Aristotle gives four reasons, actually, why this happens. And again, I'm not going to go, like everything else, he introduces it in terms of a puzzle and resolving the puzzle, and it's not clear and so on. I'm going to skip that for the purposes of this morning. It's interesting for a scholar. But the first thing he says is, our seeing a friend is pleasant. And this is another important notion. Actually, I was going to list it as another note of Aristotle's treatment of friendship that deals with psychological well-being. Something which I would call social ecology. He thinks it's important for living well that you surround yourselves with friends, the being with and the seeing of whom, the seeing whom, is pleasant. You like to contemplate these persons. And to illustrate this, I'd like to think of the example between, say, living in a prison and living among decent people. A lot of people think one of the worst things about being in prison is the restriction of your freedom. It's also the people you're with who shout and are angry and say nasty things and clamor and make noise. And prison is a horrible place because you're not with any decent people. Right? So it's a kind of an obvious point, but Aristotle does stress it. It's necessary for happiness that you be surrounded by people who are pleasant to be with for the right reasons. So I would call this social ecology. It's a very important, from a psychological point of view, it would be very important for buffering and for support and so on. So he thinks that the best sorts of friends, they want to be together, soothsaying is the Greek term, in order to contemplate, to see each other. And in Book 9, Chapter 12, he uses actually terms from romantic love. It says the way lovers want to be with each other so they can see each other, so friends want to be with each other. And he uses theoria and other contexts. And we use this language too. It's so good to see you. Right? We don't say it's so good to talk with you. It's so good to see you. And this is really very important for him. And he thinks that we take delight in seeing a friend. And he also believes that pleasures drive out pains, especially pleasures that are closely connected with the pain, so that if a friend is another self, that establishes a close connection between the pleasure and the pain can serve to drive out the pain. Now, by the way, from a scholarly point of view, we find Aristotle in Book 9, Chapter 11, using the presupposition that pleasures drive out pains, but he had stated that explicitly only in Book 7, Chapter 14. So it's kind of an interesting, a scholar will say, oh, that's very interesting, he's relying on something which he actually only explicitly articulated in the Book 7 disputed account of pleasure. But anyway, I'll pass over that. So Aristotle thinks that any pleasure serves to lessen any pain, and therefore so will also this pleasure of seeing a friend. But here one should say he presumably does not regard one's friends showing up to be with you when you are suffering as, so to speak, your friend's making himself an inert object of your attention, the way he might throw a good movie into the DVD player. I think this is very important in psychological. Aristotle's a very compressed writer, but I think he has in mind very astute and subtle psychological points in many things that he says. And I would put it this way. And by the way, Miles Berniot is very good at bringing out this aspect of Aristotle in his exegesis of the Ethics, but whenever he touches upon Aristotle. But I would say that the friend who comes to visit you to please you with the fact that your friend sees you does so as someone you are pleased to see. He would act as knowing that you would appreciate what he does. So one could think of countless examples in this regard, but this is one that came to my mind and tell you something about me. Think of the difference between bringing a fine scotch when visiting a friend and bringing the fine scotch you shared on a special occasion before and not simply bringing it as such, right? So this is a way of allowing yourself to be seen by the friend in which your friendliness, so to speak, I'm going to put it in that way, is patent. Right. And I think that this is what Aristotle has in mind. So that pleasure, which is very strong and very directly connected to your friendship, then serves to diminish your sorrow in the way that any pleasure diminishes any pain, he thinks. That claim itself we can dispute. Okay. Secondly, he says, friends, when they're with us, please us in how they speak. Now, I think this is similar, but a friend who visits to console will also say, not simply things which you enjoy hearing, but things also which he recognizes that you will recognize he is saying because you enjoy hearing them. And which you will attribute to him too in his saying them as the sort of thing he will say. So your friend knows the sorts of things you will say. You know that he will like your saying the sorts of things that you will say. And he will see that you're saying them because you understand that he will recognize them as the sorts of things you will say. And yes, in a very Gricean way, this kind of reflexivity is built into these exchanges. And I do think Aristotle means this. I do think he is really this profound, and he has a lot to say, and he has to cover all of knowledge. And that's why he's very compressed and very general. Now, these are ways in which friends lessen our sorrow by providing us with pleasure. But then there are two more that Aristotle touches upon. Ways in which friends lessen our sorrow by somehow taking our sorrow upon themselves. And the first is that they alleviate, literally Latin, you can see it there, they lighten our sorrow. And the second is that they show love through sorrowing with us. Now, on the handout, you're going to see Aristotle's text in connection with these two further bases of condolence. But I want to skip ahead first. And here I'm going to read, because this needs to be careful. Relative to his discussion, I'm going to skip ahead relative to his discussion, he presents an argument that friends do take on sorrow where they console us. Lots of times Aristotle presupposed A in giving an argument, and then later he gives the argument for A, recognizing that he's presupposed it. So he presupposes that friends do take on sorrow when they console us. That's the reason for these two further explanations of condolence. But then he realizes he has to support this, and he comes up with a really very clever way of supporting it. He says this, he says, if we consider refined rules of conduct, we recognize that it is unseemly actually to ask friends to come and console us when we are in sorrow. Yet by the same token, we should not repulse them if they show up. While we also recognize that we should be quick to visit our friends when they are in sorrow without waiting to be asked by them. Okay, so in that description, do you recognize refined conduct, yes or no? I say yes. That these are the correct and refined rules is shown by the fact that we can identify a deficiency and an excess in regards to them. The deficiency is the hardened attitude of a tough man who will actually repulse friends who come to console him. And the excess is the emotionalism of women, Aristotle says, and womenish men, who plead for friends to share their grief and actually are happy to see others suffer with them, and who even confuse that kind of sentimentalism with friendship. So it's just a fascinating discussion. He gives us both at the extremes. Now, what makes sense of the refined rules is what I'm going to call, using a modern phrase, the logic of the gift, which marks the love of friendship. Friendship is marked by an exchange of gifts rather than a strict quid pro quo reciprocity, Aristotle maintains. Namely, that it is noble for a friend freely to accept an evil or take a burden upon himself or suffer a loss for the sake of some benefit for a friend, but that the nobility of the gift is lost and perhaps even converted into something shameful if we would force or bind him to make a similar sacrifice for us. Thus, when a friend freely suffers along with us to lessen our suffering, this should be construed as a gift. Right? What makes sense of those refined rules of conduct is that we understand the friend's coming to us when we're sorrowing as his taking on a burden, which is our pain, in order to lighten our pain. So it has the character of a gift. So this, I think, is extremely clever. And I don't think I got it right in my comment in Clarendon Aristotle poem. But it's very clever and ingenious argument that friends do take on pain. And that's part of one of the ways in which they alleviate our sorrow. Now, the passage in the Nicomachean find it a relief for their friends to share their sorrow. B, that is why one might also ask whether it is as though they share one's burden, or rather their presence, which is pleasant, and also the thought of their sharing in one's sorrow lessens one's pain. well, whether it is for these reasons or some other that we find relief, this may be put aside. In any case, what we said does seem to happen. Now, just some comments on this. Aristotle presents the two reasons we're considering having to do with friends taking on pain in B. Remember, those were the friends somehow lighten our sorrow, and they show love through sorrowing with us. Notice in Greek, as well as in English, we speak of alleviating suffering, which means to lighten. The term rendered as though, hosper, leaves scope for varying strictness in a comparison, and can mean justice, though. Finally, it does look as though Aristotle favors the second explanation. But what that explanation adds to his previous point about the presence of a friend is pleasant is all contained in the phrase, the thought of their sharing in one's sorrow lessens one's pain. So that carries the entire burden of that additional reason. If this means no more than that you find it pleasant to think of their sharing in your sorrow, then we're faced with two difficulties. First, that this explanation seems just another version of the pleasure driving out the pain argument. And also, there's a puzzle which is implied by, but which Aristotle does not yet address, which I mentioned already. How exactly we can be pleased by our friend being in sorrow when, after all, he is not pleased that we are in sorrow, right? So why the absence of symmetry there? Okay, so that's Aristotle's treatment. See how compressed it is? Right? And this is one of the real interests of exegesis of Aristotle, because it's intelligent, but it's extremely compressed. So St. Thomas sees the interest of this difficulty and states it in three different ways in the relevant article in the Summa. That's the article where he discusses the effects, what remediates sorrow is the discussion of the emotion, the passion of sorrow. So the first objection, I don't have the objections in the handout, and I apologize for that. So the first objection, an effect resembles its cause, I'm paraphrasing, but it's a close paraphrase. If you put several joyful people together, then each causes more joy in everyone else, a kind of magnifying effect. And so if you put a sorrowing person together with his sorrowing friends, then all of them should be even more sorrowful as a result. Objection two, a friend is like a mirror. And if he shows sorrow in reaction to our sorrow, then we should have double the sorrow, not only our original sorrow, but also our sorrow as reflected in the friend. Third, so the first two objections Aristotle traces to texts in St. Augustine, the third he traces to a text in Aristotle. A friend who loves his friend is distressed by anything malum, anything bad, which he sees in his friend. Pain or sorrow is something malum. So a friend who feels sorrow at our sorrow suffers a malum, which should add to our sorrow, therefore, if we love him, not lessen it. Okay, and that's pretty good argument. And, you know, you wonder, how long did it take St. Thomas to dictate that to a scribe? 3 minutes. So in the corpus, he says the following. This is on your handout. I reply, it should be said that a friend who shows sorrow when we are sorrowing is by nature such as to console. And I think that naturaliter condolens is very, very interesting. The philosopher gives a twofold reason for this in Ethics Book 9. The first reason is that since sorrow is such as to weigh down, it functions as a weight. Anyone weighed down by it strives to be lightened of its load. When, therefore, someone sees others saddened by his own sorrow, it arouses in him an imagination that others carry that weight with him, as though they are striving that he be lightened of the load of that weight, and for that reason he carries the weight of his sadness more lightly, as happens too among men carrying physical weights. The second and better reason is that from the fact that his friends feel sorrow with him, he perceives that he is loved by them, which is pleasurable, whence, since every pleasure softens sorrow, it follows that a condoling friend softens sorrow. So what's going on here? Well, first, St. Thomas downplays the first argument. When we might have been hoping for a contra-Cartesian explanation that a portion of one's own sorrow really can be borne vicariously by someone else, Instead, St. Thomas seems to settle the ambiguity in Aristotle's Hospere by interpreting the sharing of burdens as simply metaphorical, and in fact as something purely imaginary. The phrase, he carries the weight of his sadness more lightly, seems to imply that he still carries the weight of his sadness. That weight has not been shifted. He walks with a lighter step while carrying that weight, perhaps, but the weight, the sorrow, is not less. Again, when he says, as happens too among men carrying physical weights, the word etiam there suggests he is referring not to how someone can help you bear some of the physical weight of an object, say by taking hold of the corner of a carried table, but rather to expressions of concern and tokens of affection shown by others when we are carrying a weight, how it can happen that these can make it seem easier to carry the same weight, also an effect of the imagination. In the Ethics Commentary, St. Thomas says plainly that it is not possible to take a part of another's sorrow which was the same in number as that sorrow. What can happen, he says, is that a friend can take on a part of the burden which causes the sorrow. For example, if a friend is saddened by a financial loss, his friend can make good for part of that loss, thus lessening the distress. Now, in any case, the second argument seems at first not to accord condolence any special role among the pleasures a friend can provide. But when we look more closely, we see that St. Thomas has, of course, glossed Aristotle's argument by bringing in the notion of love. Aristotle had referred in an intellectual way to pleasure in the thought that others share our sorrow. St. Thomas says, rather, that the other's love is such as to give pleasure. It is delectabile, and thus for the sorrowing person to perceive it is to be pleased. I don't think this is a slight difference. St. Thomas leaves unexplained here why it should be an act of love to sorrow along with another's sorrow. That's been left unexplained. So the argument presupposes that and doesn't support that claim. To find out why he holds this, one must turn to his discussion of love earlier in the treatise on the passions, and in the question on the effects of love and the article on mutual indwelling, St. Thomas says the following in connection with how the belover is in the beloved. So first he talks about how the beloved is in the lover, and then he talks about how the lover is in the beloved. That's mutual indwelling, has both of those effects. So it's very interesting, he discusses this point now in connection with how the lover is in the beloved. And he says the following, the lover is in the beloved by the love of concupiscence and by the love of friendship, but not in the same way. Now that's a technical distinction, and we don't need to go into that right now. For the love of concupiscence is not satisfied with any external or superficial possession or enjoyment of the beloved. So the key word here is possession, you want to possess your beloved. But seeks to possess the beloved perfectly by penetrating into his heart, as it were. Whereas in the love of friendship, the lover is in the beloved, inasmuch as he reckons what is good or evil to his friend as being so to himself, and his friend's will as his own, so that it seems as though he felt the good or suffered the evil in the person of his friend. Hence it is proper to friends to desire the same things, and to grieve and rejoice at the same, as the philosopher says. Consequently, insofar as he reckons what affects his friend as affecting himself, the lover seems to be in the beloved, as though he were become one with him. But insofar as, on the other hand, he wills and acts for his friend's sake, as for his own sake, looking on his friend as identified with himself, thus the beloved is in the lover. And I just gave that last clause so you can see a little bit how it construed the other aspect of mutual indwelling. So we must import this doctrine into what St. Thomas says about condolence, and then we see, to use the distinction that we drew in the beginning, that he really is concerned with what we call feeling sorrow along with the sorrow of one's friend, rather than simply sorrowing at the sorrow of one's friend. The reason why sorrowing along with another is a good thing and an expression of love is that it helps to realize the goal of love, which is union, which takes place through mutual indwelling, on St. Thomas's interpretation. It's interesting that he attributes the phenomena of compassion and condolence to the love of friendship, not the love of concupiscence. The love of concupiscence is an impulse to possess, but this work of feeling the sorrow of one's friend is a work of the amor amicitiae of St. Thomas. Love of friendship seems to have more to do with the will, love of concupiscence with feeling, if you will, consolation for St. Thomas then is more like a deliberate act of a human person rather than a spontaneous reaction of moral feeling, which I think is a very important consequence. It is also interesting and noteworthy that for him, compassion is a matter of the lover being within the beloved, not the reverse. This seems contrary to how we tend to think of it. We tend to think of compassion as a matter of recreating within our own feelings the feelings of another, making an internal model. This seems an inheritance from Descartes. We live behind a veil of ideas, and empathy and compassion are good because they allow for the informing of what is behind the veil from what is outside the veil. This approach leads naturally, when fully developed, to utilitarianism, that the limit of moral feeling for others is the assimilation within one's own consciousness behind the veil of that of all other moral, all other persons. But yet consider that for St. Thomas, as for Aristotle, compassion involves essentially the physical act of going to where the beloved is and being with him. Not so that you can perceive him clearly, but so that he can perceive you. Or consider our practices of mourning. The visitors sign the guest book of the mourner, not the reverse. Actually, it seems presumptuous to think that one's own internal world encompasses the experience of a mourner, rather than that one is admitted into the mourner's household, so to speak, briefly and as a privilege, precisely because of one's qualification that one brings along with oneself as having condolence. Aristotle says rather flatly in Nicomachean Ethics 9:4 that a mark of friendship is that friends are pleased and pained by the same things, and leaves it at that. St. Thomas's account is rich. So does St. Thomas think that his explication simply gives what Aristotle held? How could it, when Aristotle's comment is so terse and compressed? But several considerations argue that he does, that St. Thomas does think he's explicating Aristotle's own view. One is that St. Thomas states plainly that a friend is naturally designed so as to console us, naturaliter condolens, amicus est. So that it is a natural reality, not supernatural, that he's discussing here. And of course it is. That he regards mutual indwelling as the effect of the ordinary human passion of amor, which he takes Aristotle to have explained well in his books on philosophy. And Aristotle identified, St. Thomas believes, and made fundamental what St. Thomas agrees is the fundamental idea, that a friend is another self. It didn't have to be the fundamental idea of Aristotle's books on friendship. Perhaps this last point is decisive. St. Thomas, I think, is disposed to ascribe a grasp of all of the reality of something to someone who grasps the fundamental principle well, because he thinks that in grasping the principle, you do virtually see the whole of the reality. Now, as regards St. Thomas's replies to the objections, it seems a note of those replies that they spurn, so to speak, mechanistic or spontaneous explanations. We saw this already in the corpus. Condolence could not be a mechanical transfer of weight from one weight bearer to another, but rather it was a creative act of imagination in response to someone's direct display of striving to help you. The first objection, you will recall, was that additional persons magnified joy or sorrow by the multiplication of loci, we might call them, of joy or sorrow. Accordingly, St. Thomas says, in his reply, states that it is the congruity of the affection which is a work of love, not the mere multiplication of consciousness, that gives the added pleasure, even in the joyful case. So on the handout, you can see, in each case, friendship is shown, that one should rejoice with a rejoicing friend, and that one should be sorrowful with a sorrowing friend. Hence, each becomes an object of pleasure by reason of its cause. So the multiplication of joy in the case of many persons rejoicing together doesn't come from their joy, but from their congruity. It's a formal characteristic. He responds to the second objection about mirroring, and the third, that sorrow is for a friend is a malum for one's friend, and sorrow in a friend is a malum, in a similar way. The sorrow of a friend itself, considered on its own, would cause the sorrowing friend to be sorrowful, but an understanding of its cause, which is love, rather elicits delight, majus delectat. A small point here. Note St. Thomas's use of consideratio, which I have rendered understanding, in view of the fact that in the Ethics commentary, he uses the word intellectus, for this operation. And I think this is important for him. The pleasure afforded by the condolence of a friend involves an inference to the cause of his sharing in one's sorrow, which is a work of the understanding, not of an emotion. Now, we might wonder, and I'm about to wrap this up, Richard, so don't worry. We might wonder whether condolence has a purgative, as well as an alleviating effect. What I mean is that extreme sorrow, such as grief, seems to have a course or career of its own, independent of its initial cause, and for that reason is even sometimes likened by psychologists to the course of a disease. At least it is false to say that grief is always sorrow at something rather than an enduring state of sorrow provoked by something. Similarly, moods have an independence from particular emotions of sorrow. Can condolence serve to ease others out of these enduring conditions over time? Another interesting question is whether condolence depicted and imagined can play a role similar to condolence actually lived. These questions become especially salient, I believe, in relation to religious devotions, such as the way of the cross, which is an exercise in condolence, and a poem that has been very important to me personally, the Stabat Mater. The Stabat Mater has a 13th century provenance and takes on new life if we view it in connection with the Aristotelico-Thomistic account of condolence. It depicts Our Lady as sorrowing along with her son, portrays her pain in very vivid fashion, then asks the listener by condoling with her to condole also with Christ. Consider, for example, the three lines below. Ea mater fonsa moris me sentire vim dolores fac ut tecum lugiam. Well, that goes back and forth, doesn't it? Fac ut ardeat cor meam in amando Christum Deum ut sibi complaceam. Tui nati vulnerate tam dignati pro me pati poenis mecum divide. Now, in the first, understand fons amoris, font of love, as cause of love, and interpret the line as asking that Mary's love cause the effect in the speaker of sorrowing with her to sorrow along with Christ. Condolence now clearly being regarded as an effect of love. In the second, look now at the striking idea in the final clause that I may be pleasing to him. The purpose of sharing in her suffering is not to feel and to nurse within us bittersweet pleasure, enhanced perhaps by feelings of pride that our heart actually does respond to her sorrow, but rather to love him and in loving him to please him. As regards the third line, notice how this plays on the idea of condolence as a taking on of the grief of another, but now to take someone's grief is not to be burdened by him, but rather given a gift. It would be an honor and a blessing if per impossibile pains could be divided up and shared out as though they were one in number. This last reflection leads to a question about whether a sorrowing person feels any sorrow or pain at all for the pain which his friend takes on in showing him condolence. How does the condoling friend appear from the point of view of the friend who has shown condolence? We saw that Aristotle thought that the sorrowing friend did regard himself as causing pain to the condoling friend. When you are in sorrow, you know that your friend, if he showed you condolence, would also be in sorrow. And as this causes you sorrow, you're rightly reluctant to ask a friend to come and show condolence. But St. Thomas takes a position which seems to minimize or even remove the condoling friend's sorrow to the friend he condoles. The sorrow of a friend itself, considered on its own, would cause the sorrowing friend to be sorrowful, but an understanding of its cause, which is love, rather elicits delight. Does the phrase rather elicits delight mean elicits delight rather than sorrow, or elicits more delight than sorrow, or elicits delight as dominating over the sorrow? And all three interpretations are possible. Generally, when we make a sacrifice to give a gift, the sacrifice is not regarded as a loss, but rather it is interpreted as increasing the goodness of the gift. For example, if a man spends a large sum of money for a ring for his beloved, assuming he can afford it, we do not continue to think of the sum he spent as lost, or a loss for him, or an evil he endures. Rather, we regard him as reasonably gaining the delight of his beloved at the price of the sum he spent. Does it work the same way with sorrow? If so, then is the sorrow which he suffers discounted so that we regard it as not a sorrow, or at least not as an evil at all, as it is the reasonable price of winning the alleviation of sorrow of the sorrow of one's friend? Is it possible for sorrow not to count as an evil? So at least it seems that St. Thomas is more inclined to go in that direction than Aristotle. It drops out for him completely this discussion of refinement and visiting or being visited by friends in times of grief. Okay, so now conclusion. We said that if psychological well-being is the ability to work well and to love well, then for Aristotle, psychological well-being is something social, not individual solely, and consists in someone's being embedded in relationships marked by love, that is, by bonding, reciprocity, and identification with others. We said that healing on this conception would be a matter of using this network of relationships insofar as it is sound to address tears or deficiencies elsewhere. And we considered four or five ways in which, on Aristotle's theory, this could be done through fostering complete relationships, through living more outside oneself, through fostering sound institutions, through what I call social ecology, and finally through the protective action of condolence. We saw that the phenomenon of condolence is intrinsically interesting, that it involves the logic of the gift, and that sentimentality is avoided in condolence if the condoling friend condoles in order to please his friend in the condoling, not to be pleased with himself. Thank you very much.